to be insulted.
Good. Okay, we are very excited to have the first meeting of the Government Relations Committee for the Radnor School Board. I'm Lydia Solomon. I'm the chair. This is the vice chair, Lisa Borowski. We have Eric Zajac and Chuck Madden on board. Our administrative liaison is Kevin Kane, who is absent today due to illness, so Dr. Linda Grobman will fill in for him. Our topic today is the Chester Upland School District and discussion of what has occurred and possibly what could occur in the future there. But first, I'd like to open it up to public comment, if anybody has public comment. Okay. So we'll move into agenda item one, which is a discussion of the crisis in Chester Upland School District. How do we want to do this? You want to start?
And sure.
Then I'll fill in with my editorials.
So just stating some facts. Chester Upland is a school district in Delaware County, and Mrs. Solomon serves on the Delaware County Intermediate Unit Board. Chester Upland School District, I meet with them when the superintendents meet, so have they had the opportunity to meet with that superintendent and become somewhat intimately involved with some of their financial crisis as reported to the superintendents by Dr. Tom Persing, who is the acting superintendent. And just to take a little sidewalk, because all information is local, in 1983, I was studying for my principal certificate, and Dr. Persing was my teacher at then Beaver College. So it was just kind of neat to see my teacher after all these years. But I digress. Anyway, so Dr. Persing has been called in to be the acting superintendent because, as those who have been following it in the newspaper know, Chester Upland, like several school districts in Pennsylvania, are faced with a financial crisis. The financial crisis particularly hits those school districts that serve poor and minority students. And Chester Upland is, as they say, the tip of the iceberg, with Reading, Allentown, York, Duquesne, and of course Philadelphia following closely on the heels. Now, this is not a discussion about Philadelphia, but I should point out that Philadelphia is the only Class 1 school district, and so the rules that govern Philadelphia are just a slight bit different than the other 499 school districts in Pennsylvania. It all rose to our attention at the Delaware County Intermediate Unit, and I know Mrs. Solomon can speak about this, is because for many years Chester Upland has been unable to pay their bills, and one of the bills they've been unable to pay has been the Delaware County Intermediate Unit bill. Delaware County Intermediate Unit, and Chuck, correct me if I'm wrong, provides services for students in all 15 of the school districts, special education services. We are all familiar with the VOTEC schools. And in fact, when our students, our young people, are adjudicated to prison, the IU is the one who provides the program within the prison system for our students that are there. So, Chester Upland has been unable to pay its bills, and the IU is sort of at a point right now where they're sort of at a crisis mode because they are in arrears, well north of $1 million. And one of the strategies that the Delaware County IU chose to implement was to say to the participating districts, the other 14 districts, is, gee, we're going to hold back on your reimbursement so we can help cover the cost of serving the kids in Chester Upland School District. Now, I should confess, I wasn't part of that decision. I'm not here to say one thing or the other, but just to report, it affects Radnor to the tune of $28,000. For a variety of reasons, and I think I've articulated them before, that we have taken some programs back and we are serving our own kids with our own means rather than using the IU services. You may recollect most recently that we have hired a full-time speech therapist. Instead of using the IU for speech, we now have the speech therapist on board here. So it was one of the strategies we used to kind of help balance our budget, and so thus our costs, our reimbursements are not a lot. Some of my colleagues are facing a deficit of well over $100,000. So there are differences. Anyway, that's something that Mrs. Solomon can speak about because she will be asked to kind of vote on that and where they're going. Chester Upland was out of money. They could not make payroll. I think you may or may not know that our president, President Obama, invited a teacher from Chester Upland to sit with Mrs. Obama during the State of the Union because, indeed, the Chester Upland School District teaching staff had pledged that even if they weren't going to get paid, they would continue working. So they were going to work as long as they could or feasibly afford it on behalf of the children. But needless to say, it's a crisis situation. Since then, there were several lawsuits filed. Chester Upland School District filed one. The Education Law Center joined in, and they filed one, and the IU, and really kind of compelling the government to say, hey, you need to help. We can't let these 3,700 children be without an educational program. And since then, the state has come through with funds for at least to the tune, and I could be wrong about this, $3
million? Yeah, $3.2 million, but Chester will be unable to meet payroll as of February 15th.
Correct.
So it's not going to get them very far.
So it's still, it is. Although we did hear on Friday, Lisa Borowski, Lydie Solomon, and I, along with the other superintendents, attended a House Appropriations Committee hearing chaired by Representative Adolph regarding this issue. And it sounded to me, although I didn't hear it stated full out, but it sounded to me that at least till June there would be funds coming, but not anything thereafter. So I think that's like a really quick synopsis of what's going on. If you want to add something.
Well, there's a lot of layers to this, and it depends how much detail people want or need at this point. I think we should just say at the outset that we're hoping to come out of this meeting with agreement that we want to put forth a resolution to have the entire board vote on sending a clear message that Radnor, well, now there's a couple ways we could go about this. So Lisa and I have prepared draft resolutions. Another idea put forth to me was to basically put it in the hands of the administration to craft a resolution that the board could vote on. So we had allotted a large amount of time in this meeting to discussing what would be in the resolution. And we can still discuss the message that we want to send. I understand that maybe the language in the resolution that we drafted would not be similar to what the administration would come out with. They would come out with a much, we called it vanilla.
Well, no. I think that I found an article, and I'm sitting here struggling for a bit because I know I didn't make enough copies, but I will get more copies. I shared it with Brucey earlier today. There's a website called the Philadelphia Notebook. I don't know if anybody's aware of it, but they local education news, they sort of call it each day, mostly about Philadelphia, but surrounding areas. And they had an article, a guest blog, actually, on district bankruptcies, who's responsible. And I sort of think that this article summarizes all of it. So I'm going to step out for 1 second and get you more copies.
Okay.
And I trust that I can pass some this way, and I'm just short by one, so I'll pass.
And while we do that, can I just take a couple steps back to get
back.
A little bit of a broader context to the issue?
Okay. Yeah, because I think we haven't really laid out to any extent Radnor's involvement in this and why Lisa and I, and I think, I don't know where Eric and Chuck stand, but why we think this is so critical for Radnor to take a stand on this. So.
Okay, and just to give us a little bit of a broader context, Chester Upland is a Delaware County school district.
Right.
There are 15 Delaware County school districts.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. Right.
All of whom are part of the Delaware County Intermediate Unit, right. Which we always refer to as the DCIU.
Right.
And part of the financial challenge that the Chester Upland School District is in is that it gets billed for services that are provided by the DCIU and has had difficulty in meeting their financial obligations.
Well, right. That would be how it affects Radnor, because we're part of the consortium with them. But the real reason that they is your question more why they can't pay their bills? Because that's a long and detailed story, too.
I don't necessarily, okay. I'm just trying to get a sense of the interconnectedness,
right.
if any, of the 15 Delaware County school districts, Chester Upland being one of them, Radnor being one of them, 13 others being among them,
right.
and how the financial crisis in Chester Upland could potentially affect Radnor Township and the other school districts, in a sense of, you know, why it is, why, I think we obviously, I think we accept that we all have a stake in public education, but the stake may be more than just this general stake. It may be that some of the financial burdens may be felt by us here in Radnor. So I just want to, you know, put that out there as to how that is the case, and it's only to just sort of accentuate why should we should care about this.
Well, I think there's mm-hmm. three layers to why we should care, in my opinion, but this is my opinion. So the most obvious is that we're in a consortium of services with some districts that are really strapped financially, and the reason is because the state substantially cut the money that they earmarked for public education, and they've been cutting back for the past 10 years, but this year in particular they cut back a large amount. And what hurt Chester Uplands the most, why they're sort of the first to go into crisis, is because the state cut the subsidy for the charter schools. And so half the students in Chester Uplands attend the Chester Community Charter School. Chester used to receive a subsidy for the state to cover the part of the expenses for that, and that was cut. So I have a chart here that shows that that is a $10 million chunk that didn't go to the Chester Upland School District to reimburse the charter, but yet they're still responsible for the bills to the charter school. So that's just one reason.
Would you like me to explain the charter funding?
Yeah.
So
if we need to.
Charter school funds go through school districts. Currently, we have 9 students in charter schools, and we pay for our per pupil to go to a charter school. Chester Upland has somewhere around 3,400 students in a charter school. So they have to send that money directly to the school. The way that it was originally done is that a school district would send the per pupil cost, so the money followed the child, and it was a weighted factor. So if the child received Title I services, there was additional money, and if the child received special education services, there was more money. And that goes directly to the charter school, and then there was a reimbursement back to the district of about 40% of those costs. So round numbers. If the average per pupil at Chester Upland was $10,000, they would send over, actually they would send $8,000 and get back about $3,000 back from the state of that $10,000 per pupil kind of allotment.
Okay.
That money has been cut. In addition, students go to the all districts, all 500 school districts, get their special education subsidy based on a formula, and the formula is 15%. The notion being that 15% of any school district's total student population should be entitled or may be entitled or may be in need of special education services. Therefore, no matter how many students you have receiving special education services, the state will fund you at the rate of 15%. The charter schools, however, do not have that same guideline. So what has been happening at many charter schools across the state, and I'm pleased to say that a lot of our elected officials are waking up with it, to this, is a student goes to the charter school as a regular ed student. Because there's no cap on the amount of students that they can identify, they then identify the student as needing special education services and bill back to the tune of $25,000. So in the case of Chester Upland, there was a dramatic uptick in students who, when they got to the charter school, were identified as needing special education services, most particularly speech, which then exacerbated the monies going out to the tune of a huge deficit. Because Chester Upland, and let's just be upfront about this, has had decades of mismanagement, financial mismanagement. I'm not pointing fingers because I don't work there and I'm only repeating what I know. My understanding is that some of the charter schools went to the state and said, hey, we don't want the money coming through the district. We want the money coming directly to us. Therefore, Chester Upland not only got a cut in their state subsidy, as all school districts did, they got a cut, a direct cut, because the money went directly to the charter school and not to Chester Upland. So what you have are many difficult situations piling on top of each other, and so what now you have is a school district of relatively the same size as ours, about 3,700 kids, two very large charter schools that are serving about 3,400 of the kids, but they only serve them up to grade 8, which means all the high school students are now the purview of the current Chester Upland School District. The state had taken it over and had an empowerment board and lots of boards of overseers. They gave that up. They now have a duly elected school board, but they left the duly elected school board with the debt. So that, along with some flaws in the charter school funding, along with decades of problems, have sort of made an untenable situation for the children.
Right. Okay. I appreciate that. It sounds like you took very good notes at your meeting with Representative Hagel.
Oh, that one, even the notes. Just wait for the notes.
lots of facts.
And I also want to get an understanding, you know, here in Radnor, only a very, very small percentage of our revenues come from the state. But that is not true of other school districts.
Correct.
And particularly not true of Chester Upland because of the relative difference in the tax base.
Correct.
So, Ms. Solomon, when you're talking about the cut in the state subsidy, although all school districts felt it, did Chester Upland feel it disproportionately, especially compared to Radnor?
Right. That is absolutely what happened because
you don't
know. That's absolutely what happened. Radnor receives only 13%?
No, 89%, between 88 and 89% of our budget is local tax effort.
So only 13%.
About 9% comes from state funding, about 2% from federal. So when state funds get cut, and there's a little, look, I'm not going to lie, you know, when people say, well, Radnor only felt a little bit of a cut, well, we only got a little bit of money. Somewhere between 70 and 80, because they were throwing this number back and forth, of Chester Upland's budget comes from state funds. So naturally, they would feel that cut much more than we would.
And just to put an actual number on it, so their approximate budget for 11-12 school year was $96 million, of which $65 million, which is about 68%, roughly 70%, like Dr. Grubman said, is derived from state funding. And that's because they simply don't have the tax base to support public education from local taxes alone, which is what Radnor has been forced to do. We basically support our own from our tax base. So what it leads to, we're kind of delving into a little bit deeper. What I think our board should send the message out publicly. So first of all, the interconnected nature of it, that's what we talked about, that's number one. The second one is that we want to support public education. As a school board in a public school district, we feel public education is threatened by all of these things that colluded at once to put a bunch of districts literally on the brink of bankruptcy. And then the third thing that we want to point out, and we didn't even talk about this yet, is the inequalities that exist in public education right now in Delaware County, even if they restore funding to Chester Upland for the rest of the year. It's really important to highlight how unequal they are right now. So even if they do get money to continue on just as they are, we were told on Friday that they have had to cut every single honors or AP course out of their curriculum. Their class sizes in the high school are averaging around 45 students. Gym class has 65. They've had to cut all music and art programs.
One music teacher in the
district. One music teacher remains. They've had to cut all but one counselor, I think all counselors. There's one maybe left in the high school. No counselors in the elementary schools. They've cut all of their nurses. I mean, the list is stunning. They're down to just one foreign language. To me, it doesn't even meet a minimum requirement. This is a school district in our own county that even if they restore funding to the end of the year for them, what I would consider almost to limp along, it is so unequal to what we have here. So I think that our board should come out and say, you know what, we don't believe that students should suffer just because of where they live. That if they live in a poor neighborhood, that they really have a substandard education. So I would like to see the resolution encompass something along those lines as well, to stand up for the equity that children should receive, you know, what I consider at least a minimum public education, and I don't think that's even occurring under this funding formula.
I apologize, I'm not always a good note taker. I think you said there were three objectives.
Yes.
That you had in mind. One of
right.
them was the interconnectedness. One of them was the inequalities in public education, and I think I missed one.
Well, the second one was a basic just support for public education. That my idea is that the state has really shirked their obligation to fund public education. And then the third one is to point out the inequalities that exist, even if they do fund Chester Uplands as it's currently functioning. It's completely substandard to what we have here, and I don't think that I don't think that's a policy that we should support.
Okay, I appreciate where you're coming from. Let me just sort of come back to